Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to contribute to this debate on the 2018 financial policy of the government of Ghana. Mr. Speaker, if there is a credibility gap with anything we are talking about today, that credibility gap is in the analysis that we are receiving from the other side. In our analysis, we need to be consistent over the years. And if I have a few minutes, I'll point them out. In the year 2011, Ghana achieved GDP growth of 14%. The word used by the government of the day, of which my friend on the other side belongs, was unprecedented. Inbuilt in that 14% GDP growth was soil discovered under the tenure of President Donald Trump. Our friends were happy to count it as part of their GDP. And in 11 months in opposition, they suggest that oil included in GDP should be discounted for not oil. We need to be consistent with our analysis. Mr. Speaker, non-oil GDP growth for the year just gone by a little around 4.9%. This year, we targeted non-oil GDP of 4.6% based on the economy that we inherited. The current estimate suggests that we'll end with about 4.8% non-oil GDP. That is a mark of a government that is investing heavily in non-oil sectors as well and is getting the growth that we desire. In the year 2018, we are targeting a non-oil GDP growth of 5.4%, and in the medium term, about 6.8% GDP growth with oil. Another argument that has been made from the other side is the fact that even if we have stabilized the economy, then we should remove the fiscal stabilization level. Mr. Speaker, my memory serves me right, Professor Mills of blessed memory in his day achieved single-digit inflation of about 36 months. Economic stability is not an event. It's an exercise that must be maintained over the period. And so even if today we have managed to stabilize the economy, it's important to build buffers that will ensure that in the medium to long term, this stability is maintained. And that is why the fiscal stabilization is saved. But Mr. Speaker, I want to deal with just about five misconceptions that I want to throw out the moment I talk about the Ghanaian economy. First is this argument that the debt overhang that we inherited at the beginning of 2017, we have not been able to tackle or tackle. Mr. Speaker, the President in the State of the Nation address told us that the debt to GDP ratio, which had come as a product of previous years' very high deficits, was hitting about 73% of GDP. What that meant was that our debt had become unsustainable. It took a number of tactics from the current administration to begin to put the debt to GDP ratio on the path to reduction. Mr. Speaker, this year alone, we have paid about 9.7 billion Ghana cedis in interest payments in order to ensure that part of the debt that has been accumulated will begin to pay down gradually. By this time last year, our friends on the other side who make the argument that we haven't been able to do much, they have spent only 7.9 billion cedis on that same process. We have paid about 760 million Ghana cedis in net arrears clearance. By this time last year, they have paid 641 million Ghana cedis. The Speaker, the Chairman of the Committee earlier spoke about, this government has been conscious in reducing the rate at which we accumulate debt. Because as we spoke about during our day's opposition, reckless borrowing must be avoided. But while we are doing all of this, Mr. Speaker, the GDP has also been rising. From where we took up about 3.7, we projected 6.3, we are seeking to end at 7.9. We have also reprofiled our debt, and as a result, tax as a percentage of what would have been used to pay interest this year has dropped from 45% as initially predicted to 43.9. Now we are hoping to end the year around 41%. Mr. Speaker, it is a combination of these things that have brought our debt to GDP ratio to 68% thereabouts. And we are hopeful that we will meet our year-end target of about 70.9%. Are these not good things for Ghana? Yeah. They are good. And instead of pretending they haven't happened, we should encourage the finance minister and keep on that path. And we should add with debt to export ratio, debt to revenue ratio, and make progress. Mr. Speaker, the second thing I want to talk about is the primary balance. The primary balance is what measures the difference between the revenue to rate domestically and our expenditure items except for interest payments. When a country's primary balance is in deficit, what it means is that you are borrowing before you're able to satisfy wages and salaries, before you're able to pay interest on outstanding payments. Mr. Speaker, in 3 out of the last 4 years, primary balance has been in deficit. In the year 2013, when my colleagues on the other side were in power, it was in a deficit of 5.4%. 2014, 3.9%. As recent as 2016, it was in a deficit of 1.4%. And now we have to have one. Dr. Adi Mahmoud Balmia, head of Korea, assumed the reins of power, and the primary balance is back to surplus 0.3%. If there is anybody who was borrowing to pay salaries and make payments, we know who it was. And if there is anybody who can finance payments from tax revenue, we know who it is. Mr. Speaker, I want to quickly talk about our revenue targets and the argument that we are not meeting revenue and therefore we are paying. Mr. Speaker, in the year gone by, the government of the day set itself a revenue growth target of 26%. They missed it by 11%. This government set a bold revenue growth target of 33.5%, and we are not short by only 10% today. It is the revenue that we have raised up and encouraged us to fund the many social initiatives that we have spoken about. Mr. Speaker, the OECD suggests that developing economies must hit the tax to GDP ratio of between 14 and 16%. We need to grow revenues aggressively, but that doesn't necessarily mean piling and piling new taxes on people. That is why even in a year when we have removed some taxes, we are still able to achieve revenue higher than what the previous government did. By this time last year, with all their nuisance taxes, they had made revenue of 35 billion. Mr. Speaker, as I speak to you, end September, having removed those nuisance taxes and having embarked on the programs that we've embarked on, we have raised revenue of 37 billion. These are strategies do well. And the final argument, Mr. Speaker, is that because we are not spending or spending on capital expenditure, we will not get through in GDP. Mr. Speaker, GDP is a product of consumption, investment, government expenditure, and a positive net of export and import. If a government is running an economy in which private sector can function and pay salaries and they can fund consumption expenditure, government is paying its workers and they are funding consumption expenditure, the economy is still attracting investment. Export earnings are going high. Of course, there will be spending, aggregate spending in the economy that will lead to GDP growth. And that is why, in spite of the fact that they claim they spent more, we are still recording higher GDP growth than they do. Mr. Speaker, the argument is also made that if we do not spend on CAPEX, we will not achieve GDP growth. Mr. Speaker, we have chosen to spend heavily on human capital initiatives. Indeed, today the evidence exists that when you spend on human capital initiatives, you boost GDP growth. And so if we spend 400 million Ghana cedis last year on CAPEX and spend another about 1.3 billion in the year 2018, we are investing in things that will bring GDP growth in the medium to long term. A company like Apple does not invest in brick and mortar, but their balance sheet is larger than the balance sheet of this country. Mr. Speaker, as I conclude my contribution to this debate this morning, our effort should not be geared on trying to pretend that these things have not happened. We should acknowledge them, and rather we should encourage government to build on them. The finance minister said he will continue to control expenditure. Let us encourage him to succeed at that. He said he will continue to raise revenue aggressively this year, targeting another about 26% on last year's performance. Let us encourage him to succeed at that. It is only when we do this that the prayer that we say every morning in this chamber, that the coming beauty of Ghana will be kicked in our lives. Mr. Speaker, I support the motion. I thank you. Yeah.